inviting me and having me here with you today. It's always a joy for me to come and particularly speak to students. Also, faculty as well are invited also at that time. And I very much appreciate being here, having my chance to share a few thoughts with you. I'm going to disappoint Sagar a little bit because I wanted to change the topic just slightly because I hope you might find it interesting, but it's something that has interested me recently that I want to address. And it's along these lines, but as you'll see, it's not quite as he had announced. As he mentioned, I graduated from the University of California, Berkeley. And I had started there, of course, going there. I had interest when I was in school, before college. I had interest in sciences. I had interest in engineering, and I had interest in math. So I was quite good at that. But as I entered into my college time, I became interested in other things as well. And I became interested in history. I became interested in mankind's origins. And I studied that, and I graduated with that. But I've always retained, you might say as part of my nature, I've always retained a very great respect for science, and I have attained a great respect for the scientific method, something that isn't always evident when we get into the realms outside of science or that are sometimes thought of as science. Yet, as Sagar said, I did take up an inner science, you might say, an inner path, an inner journey. I met the man who became my spiritual teacher, Swami, and my life took a radical different direction because I wanted to understand from the inside. And so I took that quest, and I've been on that quest for 5 decades ever since. But yet, I do not reject the outer sciences. I admire the outer sciences, and my nature is that way, and I brought that nature also to my quest to find out what is inside. So you might say, as opposed to the outer science, I've taken up, as Sagar said, I've taken up an inner science. But yet there is a scientific method that should be applied to both. There's a famous experiment that I always was impressed with. And this goes back a few hundreds of years. And you've heard of Galileo, famous Italian scientist, who initiated an experiment that is, maybe it's a little bit of mythology with the experiment, but as you remember very quickly, he went to the top of a tower and dropped 2 balls, one very dense, another of the same size, but less dense. And dropping those 2 balls off that tower, the question was, which will reach the ground quicker, the heavy ball or the light ball? How many think the heavy ball gets there first? Oh, good, you're a nice IIT, so that's good. They reach the ground at the same time. Okay, well, of course, enough. For somebody who has studied a little bit, this is we should be obvious to us. But for the common man, it's not. Because if in a general audience, I would get a very different response. Well, he dropped those, and basically they fall at the same rate. But what always interested me about that experiment was not the results. Because what the popular thought had been at that time, well, that the denser ball would fall at a faster rate, it would grow quicker. And why did they think that? That's because that is what Aristotle had said 1,500 years prior. Aristotelian science had postulated that. But now, doesn't this seem a bit strange? 1,500 years go by, and they were arguing about this, when all it took was somebody to go and test it. Drop the balls and see. Why did it take 1,500 years? It was because there was a culture of received wisdom came down from the past. Aristotle said so, it must be so. The elder said so, must be so. The yogi said so, must be so. But who is going to test? And if we're going to make an approach to the outer sciences using the scientific method which developed Galileo is credited with being, you might say, one of the primary founders of scientific method, 17th century, that age in Europe called the Age of Enlightenment, which is a little bit ironic, but nevertheless, he did establish, and science outwardly established, this principle of testing what we assert. And I believe the same must be applied to whatever we do. Does it work? I mean, if you're going to be an engineer, it's a basic question. Does it work? If you're going to be a yogi, same thing. If you're going to dedicate time, you have to ask that question, does it work? And it's a foundation that applies to science, whether that science is inward and outward. Now, this morning, we were taking a walk here, and Sagar was showing me the buildings, this and that, and features. And as I was walking, I couldn't help but thinking back. Whenever I walk on a campus, I think back, what if I was to do this over again? If I was to take my education, repeat my education, would I do the same thing? Many years ago, I was interested in something, but it doesn't hold quite the fascination for me anymore. But I think if I was going to be in school now, what would I study? And I think two things have popped to mind, came to my mind. One would be, I thought, well, maybe I would be a climatologist. And of course, perhaps the reasoning of that is rather obvious, but it's a very question of the moment today in this world. And I thought, I would think, well, that would be something that would be of interest to me, to be able to study that and to be able to help, perhaps, in that way. But I think probably if I was able to pass chemistry, I would go into neuroscience. This would be my interest. And I think that's probably informed because of my interest in this lifetime having taken into my, this what I consider an inner science. Neuroscience would probably be my interest. When I look back, and of course neuroscience being study of the nervous system, the brain particularly, from a scientific point of view. Now, when I look back on the state of that science when I was a student, it was much different than it is now. This was back in the 1960s. At that time, it was thought that a person is born, they have a certain neurological system, their brain is such, they have a certain number of neurons that are firing in a certain pattern, and as one ages, aging process will generally take off the efficiency of the brain. Little by little, those neurons will begin to die, their synapses will begin to lose their connections. And slowly, slowly, you could say life is just a slow process of degradation of the brain and entering into old age and senility. But that's not the case anymore. But many people still think of that in that way. As you get older, you get more mentally. It's not necessarily so, or at least it does not have to be so. The modern research that has gone into this shows that the brain is actually able to display plasticity. It's able to generate synapses. It's able to regenerate the neurons themselves. As an example, if you were to, at whatever age, if you were to take up a musical instrument, it's been studied that as you begin to take up that instrument, your brain itself will begin in that region of the brain. It will begin to develop greater connections between the neurons. The neurons themselves will begin to grow in that part of the brain, and that the brain itself will begin to act as an enabler for you to be able to learn whatever it is that you're trying to learn. So let's take the example of music. If you're learning an instrument, usually somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 weeks, you can begin to see changes beginning to take place in the brain. Now you're not going to be a concert pianist in 6 weeks, but you're going to see changes begin to happen that the brain itself is going to allow you to be able to learn something, to be able to perceive your life, be able to perceive your world, your reality, your perception of it, of the relationships, to begin to change. Now, this has a great potential for us. And you can, I think you can jump ahead and see where I'm going with that thought. If we can change the brain, think about yourself, your habits. What do you do in life? If you want to change and acquire a talent, music, let's say in this case, or study, perhaps in the case of being a student, or perhaps you want to change habits. You smoke, you don't want to smoke. These things have their effect on a molecular level. It's not just a matter of thinking, well, I don't want to smoke, and perhaps I'm chemically addicted. It's more than that. It's more subtle than that. These are on a very subtle level. You can begin to change that pattern. Now, this is something that's very exciting. This brain research, another actually just interesting fact, not particularly related in this line, but I was reading a quick summary of an article. I didn't read the article itself. The summary of an article that said that meditation actually begins to affect the meditator on a chromosomal level. You know the telomeres, that little parts on the end of the chromosomes that slowly begin to break off and are associated with the aging process. That process actually begins to slow as a person begins to meditate, begins to inwardly do whatever it is physiologically is being accomplished through meditation, and the aging process itself begins to slow. So we could, as if I was to speak to Sagar's announced topic, we could talk about many of the benefits that do come from meditation, a way that's actually going to change you physiologically as well as psychologically, and make you more efficient, and is testable according to what I just said. It doesn't work. Test the results, but I wanted to take off from that point and just veer a little bit to another question that is coming up. When we speak to this question of neuroscience, the changes of the brain, and it's another summary of a scientific study that was done just recently. No, not very recently, but relatively recently, in the last couple of years. There was a scientist, I have his name written on my notes, but I forget it at the moment. He hooked electrodes in the brain, different sections of the brain, and he was able, through stimulation of the brain, to replicate many of the reported symptoms or reported states that traditionally are associated with mysticism. In other words, if you stimulate a certain part of the brain, you can create out-of-body experience. That there has to be a sense of being disassociated from the body. Stimulate another part of the brain, and you can stimulate the euphoria, a high degree of euphoria, and so on. He demonstrated a number of things that typically are associated with mystical experiences that, associated down through time, many of them. And the conclusion that he came to was thus: as we see, mysticism and the effects that have been reported throughout the ages are simply a matter of brain chemistry, brain electricity, perhaps brain stimulation. Ergo, thus, the brain is simply the generator of states of consciousness. States of consciousness are a function of brain activity. Now, you've heard this, I'm sure you probably heard this, that basically if you follow that line of reasoning a little bit further, what is being said is that matter, this physical world, the physical universe, is the basis of reality, and that consciousness is a byproduct, or you say a creation of this base reality of matter. Consciousness without the brain consciousness does not exist. Now, this is the modern, quite well understood proposal, but it's opposed and it's against a traditional counter model. Now, one of the conclusions of that first model that I just mentioned, that matter is the basis of reality, goes back also, you might say, to Galileo and Newton and the scientific method, being that the instruments for understanding reality are reason and the senses, the tools for understanding reason and the senses. Now there's a counter point of view that has been traditional since ancient times, particularly in the East, India, the Eastern traditions in the world. Maybe not so much in the West, but yes, also in the traditional West. But it's actually been developed, you might say, this counter position here in India, is that no, matter is not. Is that me? That's embarrassing. We always ask people to do what goes on. Yes, I have to speak louder. You know, it might help if you come down also. We can compromise. I will speak louder and then you come down.
It was hot actually.
But if I start to not be heard, please do raise your hand, especially anybody in the back.
And we don't have a speaker, so people can just come up ahead.
If you need to, you're perfectly fine just to come up and come forward. The counter point of view, this traditional point of view, and that I find this very fascinating and interesting, is that, no, matter is not the ultimate reality. That consciousness is the base. And that matter is a projection, a physical projection of consciousness. And that the first postulates that reason and the senses are the tools for understanding reality and all that comes from that, calculation, measurement, and so on. Opposite that, the other posits that consciousness is the basis of reality and the tools for understanding and exploring are not reason and senses, but something very different. Ultimately, it comes down to intuition. That intuition, now I'm going to come back to that word, because the same intuition seems to be a misunderstood word, but I'll have to come back to what that is meant by. Now, if I could simplify this in a statement, it would say, are thoughts individually rooted in the individual brain, created by the individual brain, or are thoughts universally rooted and perceived by the brain? These are two very diametrically opposed points of view, each of which has tremendous implications which might be true. So I'm positive thoughts, which is true. Now obviously let me go because otherwise I won't make it, but I'm going to have a time for questions. Now, if I tend to be biased in the yogic point of view, the traditional ancient point of view, that consciousness is the basis of reality, and matter is a projection of that. And I'd like to use a thought experiment for you and see if this might make sense. Imagine we were able to revive, perhaps Galileo even, or Newton, or somebody from the 17th century, and or even 18th, we were able to revive them, and we were to show them a television. And we would turn the television on, and they would be amazed And they would, and we'd say, do what you will with the television. See if you can figure out how this television works. And all the scientists from the 17th century, he would take it apart. He would take this piece out, he'd take that piece out. Nowadays there's not tubes so much, the circuits. But his conclusion would probably be that somehow that television is generating those images on the screen. He wouldn't know how I was doing it because, I mean, you look and there's the circuit boards there. But he, his conclusion would be the television generates the images on that screen. Now, why would he know that? Why would he come to that conclusion? It would be because he would know nothing of radio waves, electromagnetism, transmission devices. He would not realize that that television was a receiving station. He was able to receive, that television was able to perceive something that was being transmitted, but was not generating the images. It was taking them and projecting them on the screen. Now you can see the parallel here of what I'm implying. Is that we have advanced since Galileo's day, 400 years, not quite, 400 years since that time, and really only within the last 100 years or so, 150 years, or so, have we even been aware of electromagnetic waves, fields. These have been something that just about a fraction of time. And remember, 1,500 years went by holding on to Aristotle. I hope we don't have to go 1,500 years hanging on to the present paradigm that we are working in right now. Is it not possible that we have just but touched the hem, the fraction, or the edge of the garment of a universe that is much more vast than we possibly could understand, or that we could possibly understand in today's world? A little bit of time went by. Now, the reason I mention this is very exciting, and perhaps why I'm interested in neuroscience, is it goes back to that first observation I made of how the brain itself is plastic in a sense of moldable, changeable, that the traditional view has always been that consciousness is the basis of reality, but mankind does not perceive that unless mankind is able to develop the faculties of the brain and the nervous system to be able to perceive that, that it is not yet capable in most people for being able to perceive that reality. But we have been gifted as humans with a very blessed gift, and that is of a very evolved and developed nervous system, which has the potential to develop much further. And I suspect that as time goes by, this is one of the ways that we will evolve. We will begin slowly to begin to perceive. Now, people have no concept. 150 years ago, the idea of energy. Now, who knows really what energy really is? We can describe its action. Electricity, for example. This always baffled me, and I don't think I could make an electrical engineer, because I just wanted to know, what is it? I could be asked, people tell me it's a flow of electrons, and so on. But somehow, it seems so ethereal. It's almost mystical in a way, how it acts. But yet, we know it acts. It works. We can test it, and so we know there's something there, but yet we can't feel it, see it, or really, truly, substantively understand it, other than its effects on how to manipulate it. I think the time will come when, not that far in the future, we'll begin to see that this world of energy that we have entered into in the last 150 years, a very short time, will begin to expand, and that we will begin to see subtler realities underlying this world. Now, what does this have to do, you might say, with our situation right now? I began by saying, well, we should test. Let's test this. Let's see if we can, what this is, does it work, does it not work? And the question will come up, how are we going to test the yogi's point of view? The scientist's point of view, by testing, you can use senses, and you can use reason, and you can use measurement, and this is the laboratory where in which we are working. But yet, the yogi too, the mystic, has his laboratory. And we have to be fair, we need to be able to enter into his laboratory to be able to test as well, and to see if there might be some truth, and we have to then measure within ourselves. We, you could say, are the laboratory in which we have to make that test. And so to be fair, we have to use the tools that the yogi would use and test it within our own laboratory. Now this is what, of course, this is what yoga science is about, is about. And I do commend the Prime Minister for having this International Day of Yoga. It's stimulated a great interest in it. But of course that interest has been physical, hasn't it? It's been, which is a sign of the times, you could say. People relate to the physical world. There's another world, much more dynamic, much more interesting, and much more vast behind that physical world. I mean, well, that physical side, I don't mean to demean it at all, it's a wonderful thing. And you should do it, and you should do more of it if you're not. But nevertheless, the true science of yoga is something deeper than that. It's an ancient science that you could say is India's gift to the world's body of knowledge. It's an inner science of the flow of what in yoga tradition is called prana, inner energies and life force. That seem to be rather mystical and sort of woo science, people that, when they don't want to deal with reality, use words they can't measure. Well, it seems that way, but yet, if we enter into our individual laboratory that each one of us has, we can see that we too can measure. Now, when I mentioned this word intuition, I want to come back to that. The physical scientists, the material scientists, there's a diversion. You know, many people are afraid of yoga because they think it's, especially in the West, where I come from, USA, oh, we can't have that because it's religion. You see, I don't know if you have noticed that as much here. I haven't as much, but there is that. There's a bias against it that way. We can't have religion. Well, you know, the modern world has its own religion. It has its own religion. It's called secular materialism. It's a religion. People believe in it strongly. willing to fight for it. And so I'll leave it at that. But so let's come back. Intuition. What is intuition? And we think of it, oh, it's ladies' intuition. We sort of hear it that way. I don't mean it like that. I mean, there's a more defined, precise definition. At least in the world of the yogi, the mystic. Intuition, as opposed to reason and the senses, intuition is the direct perception of reality, the direct perception of reality without the intermediary of the senses. Now, is such a thing possible? Direct perception of reality, whatever that might be, it's not defined what that is, but the direct perception without the intermediary of the senses, the knowing of something without that. Now, think about this as a thought experiment. If you turned off your senses, sight, hearing, touch, taste, smell, body sensation, would that mean that you would no longer be able to know, perceive, be aware? Would your awareness disappear of yourself, of a sense of I am? I don't think so. I've often been tempted to try one of those sensory deprivation units that you read about. There's a fellow in Pune that's developing these, and I'm going to try them one of these days. But I did just for fun. But just the, no, there's still the sense of knowing that I am. Now, if we develop that, if we wanted to test the two modes, we know the mode of using our reason and our senses. So that if we're going to use the intuition, what we need to do is we need to turn it off. And this is exactly what the mystical tradition is about. If you follow it, yes, there's many other things, but a common thread is turning the senses off so that you then can have direct perception of what is behind the senses. And you begin to ask yourself, well, how can I do that? How can I turn the senses off? And this is what the science of yoga is really about. It's about many things, but this is essentially what it is, turning the senses off. And you would ask yourself, well, how can I do that? Well, this is why the importance in the yogic tradition of the breath comes in. If you can learn to control your breath, you can learn to turn off the senses. If you learn to turn off the senses, you can learn to have a direct perception of reality. And I would challenge you just to see what happens if you can learn to do that. Now, I have to warn you, this is not something you can do overnight, but you can do this. You can learn to turn those senses off. And I would like to challenge you to something. If you're interested in testing in your own laboratory, I would like you to go home tonight, and I would like you to sit in a quiet place, and not after a large meal, empty stomach, and sit in a quiet place and measure your breath rate. Some people, they breathe 6, 8, 10, 12 times a minute. Measure your breath rate at rest and try to cut that in half. See if you can cut it in half. Cut it in half. And what happens? See how you feel when you cut it in half. Now, if you can cut it in half again, that's even good. But I would say try to get your breath rate to 2 breaths a minute or less. That's not hard. You should be able to do that if you're in good health. And if you're able to relax yourself. Now, 2 breaths a minute is not much. I mean, that's not much breathing, but there's a long way to go beyond that. But if you get it to 2, notice, and then at the same time, if you're at 2, develop your power of concentration and try to hold your concentration very steady on something. Now, if you read, I had in my notes here, I had a list of experiences that are commonly associated with the mystical tradition around the world. This fellow, this man, he measured, this is over 100 years ago actually, he measured in the early 20th century around the world mystics, to find out what was the common theme. Dr. Richard Burke was his name. He was a Canadian. And he said, these things are common. Inner light is very common. So I would say, make your breath very short, 2 or less per minute, and focus your attention here, at this point between the eyebrows. And imagine and try to see a light at that point. Because this has been attested to throughout history that such a light exists. But it's not able to be seen because the mind is restless. Why is the mind restless? The senses are making it restless. But if you can make it go away, you'll begin to see right there the light. But you have to get the breath very, very slow. That's one. A sense of immortality. Because you begin, why do you have a sense of immortality? Because no longer, when you be, there's a very intimate relationship between your breath and your sense of ego, I, the sense of I am, this body, this personality, this, all of the sense of I, you begin to disassociate with it. And as you begin to disassociate with it, you say, you're not that body. You're not that personality. You are immortal. You belong to a universal flow of consciousness that transcends all of these things that are changing. But as long as your human senses, you don't perceive that. But try it, and you'll begin to see. You'll begin to sense, I have the sense of immortality against the club. No fear of death. Why should you be fear of death? You're immortal. You see, the body dies, yes. But why is that fear? Because you go on. You go on. And this body changes, yes. What's the fear? Elevation of wisdom and knowledge. I think we could use that. Expansion of consciousness to embrace the universe. Because once one no longer is associated and identified with this little self, and we're identified with something larger, the lake rather than the little droplet, we begin to have a sense of that's who I am. The sense of expansion begins to come. Enhanced creative abilities. Yes, if it's there. Indescribable bliss. Indescribable bliss. I think we would all like that. And, but this is perhaps the most important, transformation of one's being and moral character that is perceptible to others. You see, this is what's a little bit different. Many people, that doctor who said, well, I can stimulate euphoria. I can stimulate a sense of out-of-body experience. But did it change that person's moral character? I don't think so. I don't think so. And this is the difference, of course, people take drugs. They won't change. They tend to become more egoic. Thankfully, the tendency is. So, the change, a describable change in people's moral character and behavior. Because what's happening is, in the process of doing whatever it is that's going to be able to stimulate that mystical experience, we are changing brain itself to be able to accommodate that. And the tools for that have been the tools, ancient tools, that have been passed down from generation to generation to generation, to be able to transform that brain. And this is, and it allows, when that brain is transformed, it becomes a perceiving, a receiving station to perceive something much more vast, much more expansive than this little self that we know. Now, I mentioned, just to finish it off, and I challenge you, this will leave you with a little bit of challenge from that, is, I said, make your breath slow. That will get you closer to being able to have this experience. But two breaths a minute is still much too fast. If you really want to take this to its natural conclusion, where do you think it goes? If you want to, it's said, in yoga science, thousands of years old, the breath is the cord, the rope, the cord, the chain, that binds the soul, or let's call it the sense of self that transcends this little body, to the body. It's the cord that binds the soul to the body. So, if we really want to leave the senses behind and have that direct perception of reality, we need to be able to slow that breath down when it stops. And this is also, in the mystical literature, this also is a characteristic mystical experience, the suspension of breath. And you hear the stories of people, they go into trance state, and this is one of the qualities. But not every trance state is necessarily a mystical experience. There are other, so there's not the direct correlation. But nevertheless, it accompanies that state. Now, people will ask, well, that's ridiculous. How possibly are we going to, if I stop breathing, I'm going to die? Well, yes, maybe you will die, but you won't be able to stop your breath unless you purify all of those things within your body that is making you breathe in the first place. You see? So this is what you have. So don't worry. You won't be able to stop the breath until, because you probably have not purified yourself. And it's purity not only of body, but it's purity of mind, it's purity of personality, it's purity of attachments and desires. Until those go, the mind itself is not able to be able to become that receiving station. But don't let that discourage you from trying, because you will begin to feel some of these qualities as you approach very close to the breath becoming very strong. I've noticed in my own experiments that if I can take the breath two or less, I begin to feel a noticeable change in my consciousness. If I sit for an extended period of time, I begin to notice that. And I challenge you, if you want to test for yourself, if you want to be like the Galileo, say, let's just test it. Right. Let's see. All right. It's going to take a little time. But as it says in the Gita, even a little practice of this in your religion, Dharma, will free you from dire fears and loss, sufferings and troubles. So try it and see. And the end result that has been attested to by mystics throughout the world, especially here in India, which is the land of historically a mystic, some people make fun of that, but take it seriously. It has a great body of knowledge and wisdom here. And I think you're going to see that this mystical view of life, that is consciousness is the basis of reality. And our ability to perceive that consciousness in many, many layers of energies, phenomena, that are hidden to us, obscured to us now, because we just do not have the refinement of the brain yet to be able to perceive it, are right behind. And now, I applaud physical science. Physical science is coming from this direction to demonstrate those things that have been attested to from ancient times, which they perhaps did not have the tools to be able to demonstrate outwardly. But yet they develop alternative tools. And those tools, the difference you might say between the mystic and the noble scientist is the mystic is supremely useful, whereas the scientist may be not. So try it for yourself. That's all I ask you. As I say, test it and be open-minded and don't embrace that secular idea of materialism. And I mean it not materialism in buying the latest iPhone. I mean it as materialism in the sense that iPhone is reality. It's a projection. But the material is not the basis of reality. But it has its uses. And so think of us. Look at an iPhone. I think it's, you can see, material science is mimicking in some ways. And it's giving us images of something that this universe is much like. So I need it. I'd like to invite a few questions. My timing is just about right. And before we stop, no. We have time. Yeah. I want us to practice that reading for 5 minutes. Can we do that? Yeah. And then I'll take questions. So let's. I just want you to just practice. Can you do this? It's only 5 minutes. 5 minutes. That's not much. It's a fraction. Can you keep your mind focused for 5 minutes on what I want you to do is we're going to tense and relax just so we can relax, physically relax the body. And I want you to watch the breath, watch it come. mystical center in the body, and it draws our attention up toward the brain rather than watching it in the stomach, where you know that it's possible. But that, but it draws it down to the stomach. Let's watch it in the lower part of the brain. Just feel it coming in, feel it going out, breathing through the nose, and try to hold it there. And if you can, we don't have a second hand, but tonight go home, measure your breath. Practice this for some weeks or months. Get that breath slower, 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 without force, because you're relaxing. See if it doesn't change the impact on your life. So let's sit. Let's sit here. So I've got a chair. So let's begin. Let's inhale and tense the whole body. Inhale. Tense. Throw the breath out. One more time. Inhale. Tense the whole body. Throw the breath out and relax. Now, keep your spine straight. Better if you don't lean back so that you keep a little more dynamic posture. But the spine must be straight. Put your hands in a relaxed fashion or you can forget about them. And breathe naturally through the nose. And as the breath comes in, focus it at the point between the eyebrows or in the upper nasal passage and watch it going out. And feel as if you are the breath itself, the air coming in and the air going out. And try to forget the physical body, sense of touch. Let it go. It's like some, if you can mentally look down on your body as if belongs to somebody else. And keep your attention there. If it wanders, bring it back. And let's watch to see if the breath can begin to become very slow. Okay, open your eyes. Take a deep breath. Inhale. Hold for a moment. Now slowly exhale. Try to feel a sense of peace and calmness. We do that a couple times a day, especially in the midst of stressful situations, to be able to gain control of yourself. Sometimes the stresses of this world pull us out, take us outside of our inner center. Just do that. Watch the breath very intently, and you'll begin to bring yourself back inside into the state of center and calmness. You'll find that the intuition, which, let's see if I can figure ways to apply that to the life of a student, it's necessary. Creative abilities, knowledge, intuition, new ways of looking at things, think of it in that way. They come when you're less identified with everything outside of yourself, the senses, and you become more identified inwardly, not with the ego, not with a sense of I-ness, like this or that. That's associated also with the senses. When you let go, and just come back to who and what you really are, you'll see then you can be much more efficient. The importance of this is, does it work? Is it helpful? Does it change your moral character for the better? I think it does. But I can only say that, it's for you to test for yourself and see it. Now, there were a couple of questions. I think, was it you that had the question?
Yeah.
I think you moved.
Yes. So, you spoke about individually rooted thoughts and universally rooted thoughts.
Say again.
Individually rooted thoughts.
Yes, versus
universally rooted thoughts.
Versus, individually or universally rooted thoughts. How might that work?
No, I just want to understand in a bit more better way. Could you exemplify this?
Let's take an example. I've often found it curious. Have you ever noticed in the history of science that things are discovered simultaneously? There's even this thought, now this is anecdotal for sure, but there's even this, in our language we say, the thought was in the air. And people independently, Leibniz on the one side and Newton on the other, both coming up with calculus at the exact, almost exactly the same time. It's as if something was needed and it was drawn out to fulfill that need. But in order for it to draw, be drawn out, it obviously needs a channel. And it uses a genius to be able to as a vehicle for that. And so you find that if this might be true, that thoughts are universally rooted and we perceive them, then it would depend upon, just as if we were to use the television set. Now they don't have the dials anymore, it's digital now, but it used to be when I was a boy, you could switch the dial, you see, analog. It depends on which station you are attuning yourself to. So consequently, in any situation, you know, some people are sensitive to what is trying to be said, or what is trying to happen, or what is trying to come out of the situation. They're very sensitive. Other people are clueless, and they just cannot perceive. You could say their intuitive ability to perceive, let's say a social setting, some people can perceive immediately, and another person has that ability to perceive. It demonstrates the ability lies in the individual to perceive some reality that's happening. Now, as far as thoughts go, I will be honest, I cannot explain it. I cannot explain the mechanism of how that might be so. But I think modern cosmology is even moving toward this. Before you had this universe, what did you have? What is the seed thought? They even speak of the seed thought of this universe from which creation itself, gases, fire, and ultimately liquid and matter come from. Ultimately, it comes from thought. What is thought but an expression of consciousness of some sort? What is the, and this going back to my interest in previous studies, my interest in mankind's roots, I'm now more interested in mankind's future. But what is evolution? What's the purpose of it? Why are we here? Is there any purpose for the development of this nervous system, this brain? I think it's to express consciousness. It's consciousness exists, but evolution is a process to be able to develop a vehicle for the expression of knowing, being aware, self-awareness. And so this is what you see in human evolution, is the growth and development of awareness, self-awareness, and ultimately a full understanding and expression of that consciousness in each one of us. Now this is mysticism, of course, and philosophy more than science. Nevertheless, I think this is in the future to really be demonstrated also in the way that you were asking that question. I cannot to give a specific demonstration other than positive that is what has been suggested ancient times, and I think also modern times, coming more to that view that the ancients were actually correct. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Break the contact between the soul and the body, right? As you said.
Yes.
And if someone meditates with a breathing faster than the normal rate,
yes.
What will happen?
Breath is the, he's asking the question, breath, I mentioned breath is the cord that ties the soul to the body. What happens if a person meditates and is breathing faster? You're not going to be able to dive deep into meditation. Now there are exercises, and which is maybe what you're referring to. They're pranayama exercises for quick breathing. But the purpose of pranayama, this has a physical basis, but the purpose of pranayama is to gain, an awareness. In the yogic science, we speak of prana, which is a subtle life force energy. Okay. The first step of pranayama is to gain an awareness of it. Because there's a principle, awareness precedes control. Before you can control something, you first have to be aware of it. And so exercises of pranayama first are what they're trying to do, is learn to, through the use of breath, to be aware of a subtler life force. That's, prana, pran, has two meanings. It means the physical breath, but it also means the current or the energy of which the breath is merely an expression. And it's that subtler reality, not the physical, but that subtler reality of that energy flow, that we do these exercises so that we might be aware of that. And so there's many, many different exercises. And then once you have awareness of it, you can then begin to manipulate it. Do you realize this? We have electrical engineering students here? There's a few. Do you realize there is electrical current? This body is like an electrical current. The spine itself is a nerve, the nervous system of the spine and the brain, as a unit, is a channel through which electrical, or however you're going, whatever those impulses are that animate the nervous system, that's the channel for those movements. And it's said that whenever there's a channel, a flow, you could say, of electricity in a certain direction, what accompanies the flow of electricity? Electro, the other half of that, magnetism. Magnetism develops. And so when you have flow, you also develop magnetism. A very person with a great deal of energetic flow tends to be a very magnetic person, personality-wise, too, if you use the word in that way. And so you find there's this relationship. Yoga is built, the science of yoga is built on that principle. When we, if I said, let's turn off the senses. Well, the senses can be thought of as a flow, I'll use yogic terms here, the flow of prana from the brain and through the nervous system out into the body, animating the senses. Pulses, the senses, it's a flow. To turn them off, what we need to do is we need to reverse that flow back to its source from the brain and, let's say, the spine itself. Pull that life force, that prana, away from the periphery of the body, of the eyes, the ears, the body, the senses. Pull it away back into the spine. Now, we haven't killed the energy. We've just redirected it to a different location in the body, to its origin point. And when that happens, the senses go to sleep, we might say. But the energy is still there. Now it's concentrated in the spine. This is what we... This, if you look at the root of many of the yoga practices, pranayama being one, they have the purpose of energizing the breath, which is the flow of prana in the spine. It's said that prana is associated with currents, inhalation and exhalation, currents of movement of life force in the spine. We energize those currents, in your case, that particular exercise, we energize it, and when you create energy flow, you create magnetism. That magnetism attracts that life force that's gone out back into the source. Spine. And in the process of that, the senses become off. Let's not talk about shutting them off, because that goes beyond our practical availability right here. But it calms them. And that's more real for us. Yes, ma'am.
This is the experience behind this, trying to make the breath shorter. But, slower. But in that, does it involve a state of... Or is it just inhalation and exhalation?
No, yeah, inhalation, exhalation. No, no.
I think it can make it slower.
No. But that's
just
artificial. Don't. Do not purposely hold the breath. It won't be effective, and you're interjecting a element of self-will into it. Now, there are other exercises that do that, but in this case, no. It's just trying to forget the self and relax into it. Yes, sir.
So the question is exactly the point of view of the yogis. The yogis is that the consciousness is more fundamental than the mind. And even to prove that one, if one follows the self-practices, self-breathing practices, he or she can feel the bliss and sense of reality. But again, sir, then the materialist or the physical scientist, they can argue that that can also arise from the neurochemistry of the brain.
Yes.
So the thing that the some students are interested in. So if you can show some more mystical things.
Yes,
for example,
now how do you resolve that argument? How do you resolve that argument?
Or even if you can show some more mystical, like levitation.
I'm sorry, I can't levitate. But you see that those phenomenal expressions. I mean, that they are, you might say, side elements. I was giving a class to a group of students, and somebody asked something very similar to that. Because you know, mystics are often associated with siddhis, you know, powers of one sort or another, and it's phenomena. It's phenomena, but it doesn't necessarily correlate with the mystical experience. There are certain things that the body has potential to do that have nothing to do with moral character. so there's not a hard correlation there. But in this class, somebody asked me about that. He says, "Oh, well, we want to see powers." And I said, "Well, I'm sorry, I just don't have any powers." But then I qualified it. I said, "Well, I have one." He says, "I can choose to be happy, which is a power." Now, if you have the ability to choose how you feel, how you react to other people, to what happens to you in life, to no matter if you fail or you succeed outwardly, the building crashes, can you still maintain your calm, your happiness, your inner joy? If you have that, I think you have something. And this is really, I'd like to emphasize, this is really what yoga is about. And I want to steer you away from those other, because that's given yoga, and it's given it a bad name, put it that way. I don't recommend it.
The sense of happiness can also be attributed to the brain chemistry.
It can be.
But if somebody has some powers, then the physical scientist or the materialist, they stand with you.
Yeah. Now, the challenge that I would say for you is, if you are curious enough to know the answer to that, you are the one responsible for going inside and demonstrating that for yourself. Not to take your tape measure and your reason and your senses to verify that. You have to go inside and measure for yourself. Now, there are, I could tell you stories and tell things, but I don't want to do that, because it's stimulating a line of inquiry that fascinates people that I'd rather you not be fascinated by, because it's not going to lead you to making any transformative changes within yourself. It's that moral character part of the equation that I'm more interested in. Yes, sir.
Can you say about that, what the yoga is, and the proof which one has to do is first person proof, that something processes, I have to prove it for myself, then only I can say that. But in science, the proof is like more demonstrative rather than
yes.
being the first person proof.
Yes.
So do you think, because as in Gita, the Atma that is shown in the way Lord Krishna describes it, it seems to me improbable, means from the current five senses and the instrument which we have. So do you think, is there any possibility to
will they ever be able to meet?
Reconcile with each other, come to a common consensus that, or prove
well,
that?
It's you have to enter into the realm of philosophy there. The infinite is not provable in that way. It's not provable through the mind and the senses and the logic. But neither is it improvable. Neither is the absence of it provable, because we're dealing with two different paradigms. And but I will predict though that the paradigm of physical science as it now is an understanding of subtle forces in this world that are active in this world are limited, and that we tend to see our time in very short cycles, 100 years, 200 years, when we really must be looking at millennia to be able to see the differences. Imagine what might be perceivable 1,000 years from now, that seemingly are impossible for us now. I do think this is going to not just perceivable through instrumentation, but perceivable through brain function. I think we're going to be able to perceive realities that now we think of as mystical aren't really mystical. But yet, where's that borderline between the physical and the, which is really, it's the crux of it. And I don't think that one can ultimately include the other in the way. But I think, now that may sound frustrating, but I think what it does is it compels us to go within ourselves. It gives us that I have to be able to experientially realize it from within myself. And I do think that as we move into the future, that this is going to be more common knowledge. And this is actually, I'm making that prediction just on belief, but there are some of the great yogis and mystics have said that it won't be long that before people will have this inner perception of many of the things that the scriptures speak of as very mysterious will start to become known as common knowledge. Let's see. One more question, Ben. I'm going to let you go because I've overrun my time already.
So when I meditate, sometimes I get some vibrations, some currents are flowing in my body. So
yes.
What is that exactly like?
You're becoming aware of the movement. You're becoming aware of the life force within you moving. It's a good thing. Just observe. There are thousands upon thousands of phenomena that begin to happen once we become aware of ourselves inside. And do not become distracted by them, but observe them. And observe them, and as you go deeper into your meditation, these will begin to just pass by you. So now, one of the things that you will, if you start to slow your breath like we said, one of the things I mentioned is light. You'll also begin to hear sounds. You start to pay attention to the sounds you hear in a quiet room, not on the streets up there, but go into a quiet place and you'll start to hear inner sounds. Pay attention to those sounds because they will interiorize your consciousness even further. And these are the two very common experiential realities that come to the meditator, sound and light, but there are many others, and I'm saying this just as something to be more common than others, something like dark. And just follow them. You go into them and it'll take your concentration deeper and deeper and deeper. And you'll begin to see that your life will begin to change. And it's what's you won't be able to see, but will happen, is your brain itself will begin to change to accommodate what's trying to happen. You're going to your frontal lobe. This is why we tend to focus here at the point between the eyebrows when meditation techniques often say that, focus here, we're stimulating, and then there's actually change will begin to happen. This dynamic frontal part of the brain becomes dynamic, that you might see that more animal limbic system side of the brain begins to calm, that part of the brain that reaction response to situations in life. Somebody crosses your path, you become angry and attack them. This type of attitude, behavior, they're very primitive, which unfortunately is somewhat common. That begins to moderate, calm. And you begin to hear, and you begin to, instead of reacting to life, as your brain begins to change, you begin to respond to life. Now, there's a big difference between reaction and a response. It's like in America, they have these medical teams, and they're called emergency response teams. They're not called emergency reaction teams. A response team's considered judgment. And you'll be at, and this is what begins, you begin to make considered judgment to act appropriately to whatever comes, rather than reacting, which is a lower brain function. This begins to happen as you begin to develop that part of the brain. Now, I'm going to let you go.